The question that I raise constantly with myself, and it's interesting to talk about it with other people then, is, you know, just what is going on? Just what do you think is going on? I mean, have you backed off from it? Do you have a grip on the outlines of the problem? Or are you just sort of adrift inside the context? Because the situation is mighty peculiar, friends. What we have here is a kind of creature made out of information, apparently loose in an environment of meaning, on the surface of a planet upon which gene swarming is happening. And all of these things, gene swarming, self-reflection, production of epigenetic codes like writing and this sort of thing, have no precedent. We don't go out and collect other forms of these things. They all are generated out of us. We, as moderns, as inheritors of Cartesian rationalism, look out at a universe that our science tells us is energy, matter, conservation of mass and momentum, and yet we never notice the peculiar enigma posed by the question, who's looking? Who's looking? How is it possible that the coextensive continuum of apparent being is coordinated inside organism into an experience of ongoing becoming with which we have some kind of identification? This is very weird. It should provoke more comment than it is. I think it's fairly easy to compress the entire history of philosophy into the process of achieving age 8. By age 8, most of us, if we have the time on our hands, are able to carry out an analysis of being where we reach the conclusion that everything is events in the nervous system. You know, I mean, we understand this. We understand that light being reflected from objects then creates neurochemical events which reconstruct an image of the outer world. So we pay lip service to this idea that everything is a neurological event. But in fact, we have a very strong faith in the so-called three-dimensional Newtonian world. And yet, this is the faith that can be deconstructed on psychedelics. It shows us something which we give lip service to, but which is very hard to raise to the level of a felt experience. And that is that the world is made of language. It is made of language. This is not, you know, something you say at sales meetings to boost sales. This is bedrock, as far as I can tell, and everything else is unconfirmed rumor. Well, then, you know, what is language? What is it, if the world is made out of it? Well, then this becomes dicey, because the tool for describing language is language. And, you know, you don't have to have graduated to logic 3 to understand that there's a self-limiting program involved in something carrying out a complete description of itself. It's a tautology. It can't be done. Does that mean then that language can only be understood from the vantage point of the unspeakable? I think so. We didn't know what that meant. We thought the unspeakable was like silence. That isn't what it is. The unspeakable is the ground of language. Well, how did we get into this situation? This is part of the question that relates to what is going on. How did we get into this situation? If you came in a flying saucer and observed the Earth, I think you would come to the conclusion that the breakout process or the anomaly in the mix is the human element. Animals of all sorts have existed on this planet, integrated into all kinds of ecosystems, and only in the phenomenon of human beings do you get this breakout away from genetics, away from the raw transmission of hereditary characteristics, and into a whole new realm of being, a whole new ontos of possibility, which is epigenetics, codes, self-generated, language, song, dance, painting, chanting. All of these things are forms of expression, but they are not genetic expression. What seems to be happening on this planet, at least, and in the universe generally, is a conservation of complexity, a speeding up of process, and a conservation of complexity. Now, the ordinary theory of evolution is thought to be a theory that is confined within the domain of biology. It's a theory of how one organism supersedes another and there is advancement of form. But scientists are very nervous when you extend the concept of evolution to the inorganic universe at large. And yet, if you think about the life of the universe, as we all have learned it from Carl Sagan, you know that we all began as an infinitely small, dense, hot dot. But that didn't last long, because there wasn't much going on, because there was so much energy that no arrangements could be made. Then there was a massive explosion and a tremendous drop in temperature. And at that point, atomic, free atoms, electrons could settle into orbits around atomic nuclei, and you get atomic chemistry, which condenses into stars made of pure hydrogen and helium, which cook out iron and carbon. You get more complex chemistry with more complex bond possibilities. This allows the molecular bond to form for the first time. Suddenly, an entirely new universe of possibilities springs into being. And at the end of that cascade of possibilities is organic life. Organic life then contorts and conserves information and folds it in upon itself and replicates it and distorts it, and you get more and more advanced forms of higher plant organisms, plants, and animals. Ultimately, this process ushers into human beings with culture, electronic culture, and then finally the cataclysmic connectedness of the 20th century. From a psychedelic point of view, this is all a connected process. You see, the Newtonian scientific thing lifted human beings out of the center of the cosmos properly and set them off to one side. Small planet, small star, small galaxy, to one side. And that may have been a refreshing dose of realism to the monotheistic ego that had been created out of the medieval eschatology. But in a way, it's unsatisfying, because the felt presence of experience has a centrality to it. I mean, we do feel that we are important, at least to ourselves. Well, can we create a metaphysic that is true to what is observed of the universe and true to our intuition? Yes, we can, if we see history as the inheritor and the culminating process of all these other processes. And then if we see ourselves installed at the cutting edge, at the leading edge of history, as its major players and actors. The Earth is a living organism, yes, but it's also a reflected, minded organism. And this is beyond what Lovelock and all those people are willing to say. This is not based on science. This is based on the experience of meeting the management on the other side of science. The Earth is some kind of conscious intellect, and it is managing itself toward an end. We are embedded in a plan. We are not a breakaway mutation. We are a desperate response to something.